Okay, let's bow our heads for prayer, and then afterwards, Ruth will come up and give a children's story. Heavenly Father, what a privilege we have. I mean, you just give to us just so we can have the privilege of giving to others, and that's just the way you are, and there isn't anybody that gives more than you. So may all of us feel your generosity and then feel the privilege of giving that to others. Thank you that you've encouraged us to have an adventurers program to where we can ultimately encourage our kids to be in the kingdom with you, because that's what this is all about. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, kids, if you want to come up, I was instructed by Dennis that you're supposed to collect checks and credit cards. So bring those up.
Our story is about all you ever need. So if you come a little closer, I have some pictures to show you. So if you come a little closer, it'll be easier for you to see the pictures. But I'll walk around a little bit. Years ago, there was a village in a desert land. In this dry land, there was very little water. It seldom rained, but when it did, people scurried about, capturing what they could in buckets and pails. Every drop was like purest gold. But even though the land was dry, the people were never thirsty, for nearby lived a man named Tobias who owned a deep wellspring from which poured clear, cool water. The people called Tobias the Water Master, and they loved him very much. He shared his treasure with everyone in the village. All they had to do was ask, and the water master would gladly let them dip into his well. "Drink all you want," he offered. Not only did Tobias share from his well, but he taught his son to do this also. Tobias and his son Julian would help the people dip their buckets and carry their loads. Day after day, the people would come to the well. Tobias would smile and say, "Take all you need." He would talk to the people about their lives. He would laugh with them and inquire about their hopes and dreams, while Julian helped them draw water for their families. Tobias was a kind friend, always ready to help the villagers. One day, the water master announced to the village, "My son and I are going away for a while. While we're gone, my servant Elzevir will watch over the well. He will give you all the water you need." With that, the water master and his son turned and walked up the road leading from the village. The people were sad to see them leave, but they trusted Elzevir to supply their needs, and indeed Elzevir did just as the water master said. Each day when the villagers came to ask for water, he eagerly filled their buckets. As he did, he told the people, "Take all you need. There is plenty of water for all." For a time, the villagers went about their business as usual. But then one day, Elzevir noticed that the villagers were not grateful for what they had received. They just took their full buckets and raced away without one word of thanks. This troubled Elzevir so much that he decided to stop giving water to everyone. He forgot the water master's kindness to all. Instead, he announced to the villagers, "From now on, I will not give water to those who aren't thankful." The people were surprised. After Elzevir's announcement, all the villagers tried hard to remember to thank him when they received the water. Sometime later, Elzevir noticed that some of the people were unkind to their neighbors and mean to their animals. Again, the substitute water master was bothered. He determined to give water only to the nice people. If you are mean to your animals or unkind to your neighbors, you will get no water, he announced. The people worked hard to please Elzevir so they wouldn't go thirsty. But as time passed, the taskmaster continued to find some new fault with the people. "You are too busy. You are too lazy. You're not quick enough, or smart enough, or pretty enough." With each decision, fewer people were given water. Over time, the villagers grew sad and angry. "How can we ever be good enough for Elzevir?" they questioned. "We'll all die of thirst," they cried. As Elzevir's rules grew longer, the line for water grew shorter. The people, growing thirsty, began to give up. "It's no use," the people cried. "We can't please you." In the midst of the shouting, a quiet figure approached the gathered villagers. Elzevir eyed the man suspiciously. "Another thirsty soul, no doubt," he growled. "Can you show that you are worthy of this water?" The man quietly strode to the well and turned to the people. "I have come to help you," he said. Elzevir was angry. "Just who do you think you are?" The man removed his cloak. The villagers gasped. When they saw the familiar face, they began to whisper among themselves. "I am Julian, the son of the water master. My father sent me to share the water with all the people." At that, the people cheered. Elzevir became afraid. The villagers wanted revenge. "No water for Elzevir," they shouted. The son held up his hand to the crowd to quiet them. "My father's water is a gift to all," he said patiently. "But Elzevir was so cruel to us." "I know he was. But if water were given only to good people, who could drink?" No one spoke. The son placed his hand on Elzevir's shoulder. "Freely you have received, freely give." The people looked at each other and were silent. They knew the son's words were wise and true. And so, from that day on, Elzevir was forgiven, and the water was shared freely. And let's remember to have a good week and share freely with everyone else what God has given us. Thank you. You may go back to your seats.
On. Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. Please stand and worship with us this morning.
Forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior. Take me as you find me, with all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe.
The whole Bible is about love, just telling the story of love and how he loved us, because God is love. What love the Father has lavished upon us that we should be called his children. We need to think, and we can never fully understand it as humans. That's something we're not okay with, because we need to put things in a box and understand them. But this is something we can't understand. We can never understand how he loves us.
to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If his grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. And heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss, and my heart turns violently inside my chest. But I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way.
Forward for garden of prayer.
Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the privilege of being in your house today, to be able to give you praise and worship, glory and honor for being the creator of everything. Dear Lord, today as we look around us, as we see the world and the upheaval that it's going through, we know that you're there with your arms stretched out to those of your children that love you. So thank you, dear Lord. As we see this happening around us, we know that it's a day closer to your coming, that we'll all be taken to heaven to be your servants, to be with you, to live eternity. Dear Lord, we know that the suffering that's going on has even infiltrated this congregation. We know that there's those that have sicknesses and have issues with relationships, financial worries, family problems. Dear Lord, we just ask that you comfort them. We also ask that you send your Holy Spirit to be here to engulf this church, to touch our hearts. And as the song says, how much you love us. Help us each and every day as we go through our devotions, as we talk to you. Teach us how to love, not only you, but how you love. And that we can take this love and love each other. Help us to make these baby steps until one day, dear Lord, we do things that please you greatly. So thank you for your love. And Lord, today I want to lift up a few people, and I want to also thank you for being you and also for listening to our prayers and acting on them. I pray for my wife, Lori, as she's going on the journey to help others that have been stricken by cancer, and that she is a cancer patient as well. Continue to bless her and be with her. We also know that Sheila Rogers' mother has been diagnosed with a cancer, and that the doctors have not given her much hope, but they're going to get together on Tuesday and decide what the treatment is next. And we just pray, dear Lord, that you impress upon these doctors to accept her into the program and to be able to give her the routine and the procedure that she needs. Once again, dear Lord, we want to thank you for being able to come to your altar and to lay our burdens at your feet, and also to give you praise and honor and glory for everything that's in our life. We pray these things according to your will and in your Son's most precious name. Amen. Thank you, praise team. Today we're finishing up our Revelation seminar, and then we're going to top it off today at today's service by Pastor Marquis Laughlin. He's going to recite to us the last chapters of Revelation, and I'm very much looking forward. Ever since I knew that he was going to come, I've been extremely excited. So be with me and help welcome Pastor Laughlin.
Thank you. Thank you. Good. Hey. Thank you. I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and I've got three kids and one on the way. And I have been presenting the Book of Revelation for 19 years. I travel all over the world, usually a couple of times outside of the country every year, but I do 50 to 70 presentations like this in churches all over the country every year. And I get to a lot of different denominations, a lot of different churches, and I get to share just God's Word. So it's just such an awesome privilege. Everywhere I'm invited, I feel the privilege of being able to be where people long to hear God's words, and to be able to just to be part of edifying his people is such a privilege. So I'm going to share chapters 12 through 22 from the book of Revelation. A great and wondrous sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with a moon under her feet, and a crown of 12 stars on her head. She was pregnant and cried out in pain as she was about to give birth. Then another sign appeared in heaven, an enormous red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on his heads. His tail swept a third of the stars out of the sky and flung them to the earth. Now the dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth so that he might devour her child the moment it was born. She gave birth to a son, a male child, who will rule all the nations with an iron scepter, and her child was snatched up to God and to his throne. Now the woman fled into the desert, to the place prepared for her by God, where she might be taken care of for 3.5 years. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back, but he was not strong enough. And they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray, was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then there came a loud voice from heaven saying, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Amen. Therefore, rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. Amen. But woe to the earth and to the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury, because he knows that his time is short." Now, when the dragon saw that he had been hurled to the earth, he pursued the woman who had given birth to the male child. The woman was given the 2 wings of a great eagle so that she might fly to the place prepared for her in the desert, where she'd be taken care of by God for 3.5 years out of the serpent's reach. But then, from his mouth the serpent spewed water like a river to overtake the woman and to sweep her away with the torrent. But the earth helped the woman by opening its mouth and swallowing the river that the dragon had spewed out of his mouth. Then the dragon was enraged at the woman, and he went off to make war against the rest of his offspring, those who obey God's commandments and hold to the testimony of Jesus. And the dragon stood on the shore of the sea, and I saw a beast coming out of the sea. It had 7 heads and 10 horns with 10 crowns on its horns, and on each head a blasphemous name. Now the beast I saw resembled a leopard, but had feet like those of a bear and a mouth like that of a lion. The dragon gave the beast his throne and his power and great authority. One of the heads of the beast seemed to have had a fatal wound, but the fatal wound had been healed. The whole world was astonished and followed the beast. Men worshiped the dragon because he had given authority to the beast. And they also worshiped the beast and asked, who is like the beast? I mean, who can make war against him? Now the beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies and to exercise his authority for 3.5 years. He opened his mouth to blaspheme God and to slander his name and his dwelling place and those who live in heaven. And he was given power to make war against the saints and to conquer them. And he was given authority over every nation, people, tribe, and language. All the inhabitants of the beast, all the inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast. All whose names have not been written in the book of life belong to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world. He who has an ear, let him hear. If anyone is to go into captivity he will go. If anyone is to be killed with the sword he will be killed. This calls for patient endurance and faithfulness on the part of the saints. Then I saw another beast coming out of the earth. He had 2 horns, like a lamb, but he spoke like a dragon. He exercised all the authority of the first beast on his behalf, and he made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast whose fatal wound had been healed. And he performed great and miraculous signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven to earth in full view of men. Now, because of the signs he was given power to do on behalf of the first beast, he deceived the inhabitants of the earth. He ordered them to set up an image in honor of the beast who was wounded by the sword and yet lived. And he was given power to give breath to the image of the first beast so that it could speak. And to cause all who refused to worship the image to be killed. He also forced everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on his right hand or on his forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of his name. This calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, let him calculate the number of the beast, for it is man's number. His number is 666. Then I saw the Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000 who had his name and his father's name written on their foreheads. And I heard a sound from heaven, like the roar of rushing waters and like loud peals of thunder. The sound I heard, it was like that of harpists playing their harps. And they sang a new song, before the throne, before the four living creatures and the elders. No one could learn the song except the 144,000 who had been redeemed from the earth. See, these are those who did not defile themselves with women, for they kept themselves pure. They were purchased as firstfruits to God and the Lamb. They follow the Lamb wherever he goes. No lie was found in their mouths. They are blameless. Then I saw an angel flying in midair, having the eternal gospel to proclaim to those who live on the earth. To every nation, tribe, people, and language, he said in a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him who made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and the springs of water." Amen. A second angel followed him and said, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great, which made all the nations drink the maddening wine of her adulteries." A third angel followed them and said in a loud voice, "If anyone worships a beast in his image or receives his mark on the forehead or on the hand, he too will drink of the wine of God's fury, which has been poured full strength into the cup of his wrath. He will be tormented with burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and of the Lamb, and the smoke of their torment rises forever and ever. There is no rest, day or night, for those who worship the beast in his image, or for anyone who receives the mark of his name." This calls for patient endurance on the part of the saints who obey God's commandments and remain faithful to Jesus. Then I heard a voice from heaven say, "Write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labor, for their deeds will follow them." Then I looked, and there before me was a white cloud. And seated on the cloud was one like a son of man, with a crown of gold on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. Then I saw an angel coming out of the temple. He called in a loud voice to him who was seated on the cloud. He said, "Take your sickle and reap, for the time to reap has come, for the harvest of the earth is ripe." So he who was seated on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the earth was harvested. Another angel came out of the temple, and he too had a sharp sickle. Still another angel, who had charge of the fire, came from the altar. He called in a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, "Take your sharp sickle and gather the clusters of grapes from the earth's vine, because its grapes are ripe." The angel swung his sickle on the earth, gathered its grapes, and threw them into the great winepress of God's wrath. They were trampled in the winepress outside the city, and blood flowed from the press, rising as high as a horse's bridles for a distance of 180 miles. I saw in heaven another great and marvelous sign: the seven angels with the seven last plagues. Last because with them God's wrath is completed. And I saw what looked like a sea of glass mixed with fire, and standing beside the sea, those who had been victorious over the beast in his image and over the number of his name. They held harps given to them by God and sang the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. It's "Great and marvelous are your deeds, Lord God Almighty. True and just are your ways, King of the ages. Who will not fear you, O Lord, and bring glory to your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship before you, for your righteous acts have been revealed." After this, I looked, and in heaven the temple, that is, the tabernacle of the testimony, was opened. And out of the temple came the seven angels with the seven plagues. They were dressed in clean, shining linen and wore golden sashes around their chest. Then one of the four living creatures gave to the seven angels seven golden bowls filled with the wrath of God who lives forever and ever. And the temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power. And no one could enter the temple until the seven plagues of seven angels were completed. Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying, "Go and pour out the seven bowls of God's wrath on the earth." The first angel went and poured out his bowl on the land. And ugly and painful sores broke out on the people who had the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. The second angel poured out his bowl on the sea, and it turned into blood like that of a dead man. And every living thing in the sea died. The third angel poured out his bowl on the rivers and on the springs of water, and they became blood. Then I heard the angel in charge of the water say, "You are just in these judgments, you who are and who were the Holy One, because you have so judged. For they have shed the blood of your saints and prophets, and you have given them blood to drink as they deserve." And I heard the altar respond, "Yes, Lord God Almighty, true and just are your judgments." The fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and the sun was given power to scorch people with fire. They were seared by the intense heat, and they cursed the name of God who had control over these plagues. But they refused to repent of what they had done. The fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom was plunged into darkness. Men gnawed their tongues in agony and cursed the God of heaven because of their pains in their sores. But they refused to repent and glorify him. The sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up to prepare the way for the kings from the east. Then I saw three evil spirits that looked like frogs. They came out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. They are spirits of demons performing miraculous signs, and they go out to the kings of the world to gather them together for the battle on the great day of God Almighty. Behold, I come like a thief. Blessed is he who stays awake and keeps his clothes with him, so that he may not go naked and be shamefully exposed. Then they gathered the kings together to the place that in Hebrew is called Armageddon. The seventh angel poured out his bowl into the air, and there came a loud voice from the throne saying, "It is done." Amen. Then there came flashes of lightning, rumblings, and peals of thunder, and a severe earthquake. I mean, no earthquake like it has ever occurred since man has been on earth. So tremendous was the quake. The great city was split into three parts, and the cities of the nations collapsed. God remembered Babylon the Great and gave her the cup filled with the wine of the fury of his wrath. Every island fled away, and the mountains could not be found. From the sky, huge hailstones of about 100 pounds each fell upon men. And they cursed God on account of the plague of hail, because the plague was so terrible. One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls, he came and he said to me, "Come, I will show you the punishment of the great prostitute who sits on many waters. With her, the kings of the earth committed adultery, and the inhabitants of the earth were intoxicated with the wine of her adulteries." Then the angel carried me away in the spirit to a desert. There I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet beast that was covered with blasphemous names and had seven heads and 10 horns with 10 crowns on its horns. The woman was dressed in purple and scarlet and was glittering with gold, precious stones, and pearls. She held a golden cup in her hand, filled with abominable things and the filth of her adulteries. This title was written on her forehead: "Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of prostitutes and of the abominations of the earth." I I saw that the woman was drunk with the blood of the saints, the blood of those who bore testimony to Jesus. When I saw her, I was greatly astonished. But then the angel said to me, "Why are you astonished? I will explain to you the mystery of the woman and of the beast she rides, which has the 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast you saw once was, now is not, and yet will come up out of the abyss and go to its destruction. The inhabitants of the earth, whose names have not been written in the book of life, belong to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world, will be astonished when they see the beast, because he once was, now is not, and yet will come." This calls for a mind with wisdom. The 7 heads are 7 hills on which the woman sits. They are also 7 kings. 5 have fallen, 1 is, the other is not yet come, but when he does come, he must remain for a little while. Now the beast who once was, now is not, and yet will come, is an 8th king. He belongs to the 7 and is going to his destruction. The 10 horns you saw are 10 kings who have not yet received a kingdom, but who for 1 hour will receive authority as kings along with the beast. They have one purpose and will give their power and authority to the beast. They will make war against the Lamb, but the Lamb will overcome them, because he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and with him will be his called, chosen, and faithful followers. Then the angel said to me, "The waters you saw where the prostitute sits are peoples, nations, multitudes, and languages. The beast in the 10 horns you saw will hate the prostitute. They will bring her to ruin and leave her naked. They will eat her flesh and burn her with fire. For God has put it into their hearts to accomplish his purpose by agreeing to give the beast their power to rule until God's words are fulfilled. The woman you saw is the great city that rules over the kings of the earth." Then I saw a mighty angel coming down from heaven. He had great authority, and the earth was illuminated with his splendor. With a mighty voice, he shouted, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She's become a home for demons and a haunt for every evil spirit, a haunt for every unclean and detestable bird. For all the nations have drunk the maddening wine of her adulteries. The kings of the earth committed adultery with her, and the merchants of the earth grew rich from her excessive luxuries." Then I heard a voice from heaven say, "Come out of her, my people, so that you will not share in her sins, so that you will not receive any of her plagues, for her sins are piled up to heaven, and God has remembered her crimes. Give back to her as she has given. Pay her back double for what she has done. Mix her a double portion from her own cup. Give her as much torture and grief as the glory and luxury she gave herself. In her heart she boasts, 'I sit as queen, I am not a widow, and I will never mourn.' Therefore, in one day her plagues will overtake her, death, mourning, and famine. She will be consumed by fire, for mighty is the Lord God who judges her." Now when the kings of the earth who committed adultery with her and shared her luxury see the smoke of her burning, they will weep and mourn over her, terrified at her torment. They will stand far off and cry, "Woe, woe! Oh, Babylon, city of power, in 1 hour your doom has come." The merchants of the earth will weep and mourn over her because no one buys their cargoes anymore. Cargoes of gold, silver, precious stones and pearls, fine linen, purple, silk and scarlet cloth, every sort of citron wood and articles of every kind, made of ivory, costly wood, bronze, iron and marble, cargoes of cinnamon and spice, of incense, myrrh and frankincense, of wine and olive oil, fine flour and wheat, to cattle and sheep, horses and carriages, and bodies and souls of men. They will say, "The fruit you long for is gone from you. All your riches and splendor have vanished, never to be recovered." The merchants who sold these things and gained their wealth from her will stand far off. When they see the smoke of her burning, they will exclaim, "Woe, woe, oh great city, dressed in fine linen,
purple, silk, and scarlet, and glittering with gold, precious stones, and pearls. In 1 hour, such great wealth has been brought to ruin.
Every sea captain and all who travel by ship, the sailors and all who earn their living from the sea will stand far off. When they see the smoke of her burning, they will exclaim, was there ever a city like this great city? They will throw dust on their heads and with weeping and mourning cry out, woe, woe, oh great city, where all who had ships on the sea became rich through her wealth. In 1 hour, her doom has come. Rejoice over her, O heavens. Rejoice, saints and apostles and prophets, for God has judged her for the way she treated you. Then a mighty angel picked up a boulder the size of a large millstone, and he threw it into the sea, and he said, with such violence, the great city of Babylon will be thrown down, never to be found again. The music of harpists and musicians, flute players and trumpeters will never be heard in you again. No workman of any trade will ever be found in you again. The sound of a millstone will never be heard in you again. The light of a lamp will never shine in you again. The voice of bridegroom and bride will never be heard in you again. Your merchants were the world's great men. By your magic spell, all the nations were led astray. In her was found the blood of the saints and of the prophets and of all who have been killed on the earth. After this, I heard what sounded like a great multitude in heaven shouting, hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for true and just are his judgments. He has condemned the great prostitute who corrupted the earth by her adulteries. He has avenged on her the blood of his servants. And again they shouted, hallelujah! The smoke from her goes up forever and ever. The four living creatures and the 24 elders who were seated on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worship God, saying, amen. Hallelujah. Then I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, both small and great. Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters and like loud peals of thunder shouting, hallelujah! For our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory. For the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear. Fine linen stands for the righteous acts of the saints. Then the angel said to me, write, blessed are those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb. And he added, these are the true words of God. Well, at this, I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, do not do it. I'm a fellow servant with you and with your brothers and of all who hold to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God. Amen. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Then I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and True. With justice he judges and makes war. His eyes are like blazing fire, and on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but he himself. He's dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, bright and clean. Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter. He treads the fury of the winepress of the wrath of God Almighty. On his robe and on his thigh, he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Then I saw an angel standing in the sun, who cried out in a loud voice to all the birds flying in midair. He said, come, gather together for the great supper of God, so that you may eat the flesh of kings, generals, and mighty men, of horses and their riders, and the flesh of all people, free and slave, small and great. Then I saw the beast
and the kings of the earth, and their armies gathered together to make war against the rider on the horse and his army. But the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet who had performed the miraculous signs on his behalf. With these signs he had deluded those who had received the mark of the beast and worshipped his image. The two of them were thrown alive into the fiery lake of burning sulfur. The rest of them were killed with the sword that came out of the mouth of the rider on the horse. And all the birds gorged themselves on their flesh. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven, having the key to the abyss, and holding in his hand a great chain. He seized the dragon, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray, and he bound him for 1,000 years. He threw him into the abyss and locked and sealed it over him to keep him from deceiving the nations anymore until the 1,000 years are ended. After that, he must be set free for a short time. And I saw thrones on which was seated those who had been given authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded because of their testimony for Jesus and because of the word of God. They had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received his mark on their foreheads or their hands. They came to life and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. The rest of the dead did not come to life until 1,000 years were ended. You see, this is the first resurrection. Blessed and holy are those who have part in the first resurrection. The second death has no power over them, but they will be priests of God and of Christ and will reign with him for 1,000 years. Now, when 1,000 years are ended, Satan will be released from his prison, and he will go out to deceive the nations in the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. In number, they are like the sand on the seashore. They marched across the breadth of the earth and surrounded the camp of God's people, the city he loves. But fire came down from heaven to earth and devoured them. And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur where the beast and the false prophet had been thrown. They will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. Earth and sky fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that are in it, and death and hell gave up the dead that are in them. And each person was judged according to what he had done. Then death and hell were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. If anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. Then I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Now the dwelling of God is with man, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new."
Then he said to me, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, it is done. I'm the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To him who is thirsty, I will give to drink without cost from the spring of the water of life. He who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. One of the seven angels who had the seven bowls, he came and he said to me, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. And he carried me away in the spirit to a mountain great and high. And he showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. It shone with the glory of God, and its brilliance was like that of a very precious jewel, like a jasper, as clear as crystal. It had a great high wall with 12 gates and with 12 angels at the gates. On the gates were written the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. There were 3 gates on the east, 3 in the north, 3 in the south, and 3 in the west. The wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were written the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. Now the angel who talked with me had a measuring rod of gold to measure the city, its gates, and its walls. The city was laid out like a square, as long as it was wide. He measured the city with the rod, and he found it to be 1,500 miles in length, and it is wide and high as it is long. He measured its wall. It was 215 feet thick by man's measurement, which the angel was using. That the wall was made of jasper, and the city of pure gold, like transparent glass. The foundations of the city walls were decorated with every kind of precious stone. The first foundation was jasper, the second sapphire, the third chalcedony, the fourth emerald, the fifth sardonyx, the sixth carnelian, the seventh chrysolite, the eighth beryl, the ninth topaz, the tenth chrysoprase, the 11th jacinth, and the 12th amethyst. The 12 gates were 12 pearls, each gate made of a single pearl. The great street of the city was made of pure gold, as pure as glass. Now, I did not see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city does not need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. On no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book of life. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit and yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. See, no longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be written on their foreheads. They will not need the light of the lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever. The angel said to me, these words are trustworthy and true. The Lord, the God of the spirits of the prophets, sent his angel to show his servants the things that must soon take place. Behold, I am coming soon, Blessed is he who keeps the words of the prophecy of this book. I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. And when I had heard and seen them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who had been showing them to me. But he said to me, do not do it. I am a fellow servant with you and with your brothers the prophets and of all who keep the words of this book. Worship God. Then the angel said to me, do not seal up the words of the prophecy of this book, because the time is near. Let him who does wrong continue to do wrong. Let him who is vile continue to be vile. But let him who does right continue to do right. And let him who is holy continue to be holy. Behold, I am coming soon, and my reward is with me, and I will give to everyone according to what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes, that they may have the right to go through the gates into the city. Outside are the dogs, those who practice magic arts, the murderers, the sexually immoral, and everyone who loves and practices falsehood. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to give you this testimony for the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride say, come! And let him who hears say it, come! Whoever is thirsty, let him come. Whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. I warn everyone who hears the words of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds anything to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. And if anyone takes words away from this book of prophecy, God will take away from him his share in the tree of life and in the holy city which are described in this book. He who testifies to these things says, yes, I am coming soon. Amen. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with God's people. Amen. 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 I got saved in Hollywood. I'm from Seattle originally and went to a dramatic arts program, Washington State University, moved down to Los Angeles to pursue fame and fortune in film. Started getting mentored by Morgan Freeman and God got a hold of me. A friend of mine took me to a church, bought me a Bible, shared the gospel with me. I got baptized and I said, God, what do you want me to do? I think I'm an actor, but if you want me to do something else, that's fine. And God just put it on my heart to speak his words. And I was fascinated that these are the best, this is the best script you could ever have. So I started memorizing the book of Revelation. I was fascinated by the end times. And I wanted to write something and perform it, but I kept writing and rewriting my script, and I got convicted because I was learning so much, and I was reading so many different books and different interpretations, and all kinds of people that are well-respected with PhDs and libraries of books they've written, and they would disagree with each other, and pretty soon I started to find flaws in their books because I was into it so much. So I got frustrated. I said, God, what do you want me to do? I mean, what if I write something and a few years from now I turn back and look and go, I've misled people because I just didn't know. And so he said, why don't you know more of my word? That will help you. You know the words accurate. These books, you don't really know. So I thought, that's probably a pretty good idea. So I said, I started memorizing Revelation. I had a friend of mine who was a roommate. He wanted to memorize the book of Romans. So we said, okay, we'll do so much a week. We would hold each other accountable every week. We'd get together and do our verses. And I had a 45-minute commute to work. I was working in Beverly Hills. And I'd drive over the hill and listen to Revelation half of it. And on the way back, I'd listen to the other half. And about a year went by, I started to be able to do it, barely. And then I had a friend who had been watching me. She said, you know, I'm gonna help you get this started. So we rented out a playhouse, and we did 7 performances of Revelation. We invited all our friends, filled the place up, and I did 2 weekends worth of Revelation. That was 1996, and God has blessed me ever since I put these words in my head and my heart. And every day, nearly every day, I get to see something new, and it's changed the way I see all of the Bible. It's the culmination of all of Scripture, and our misinterpretations are because we're not that familiar with all the Scriptures, all that the prophets say. So it's like going into a final where you haven't been there to take the quizzes. That's what it's like when you go into Revelation. So it takes some patience, and you got to go back and see what John's constantly referring to, and allow the Bible to interpret the Bible, and that's a humbling, slow process. That's the journey I'm on. That's the journey we're all on. And I always tell everybody, when the Lord comes back, we're all going to have all of our theology straightened out. We'll be on one page. And what's happening as we're getting closer to the Lord's return, I'm watching the church. I'm being asked to go to more and more different types of denominations than I ever have. And what's happening is, just with a little bit of persecution, we're seeing the church universal divide into one of two churches. Across every denomination, this is happening. You're either in a church that has a high view of the Scriptures and the Bible, teach and preach all of it, is not ashamed of it, doesn't pick and choose, doesn't shy away. That church invariably has Jesus as the hero. Or you're in a church that has a low view of Scripture. Says, you know what? Some parts of this we don't believe. Some parts we just don't preach or teach on. And in that church, invariably, somebody else is the hero. Maybe it's you because it's all about your life. Or maybe it's the pastor or whatever. But that's the difference. So believers are universally having to choose to cling and hold on to God's words and promises and believe them or reject them. And so the fact that you've asked me to come here and present God's word, that shows me, your church, that you have a high regard of God's word. And Jesus is the hero. He's the hero of this story of history. And this is the culmination that you just heard. So this is where we're going, folks. Amen. And if you're focused on the finish line, it will burn the dross off of your life. People ask me what the biggest blessing I've got from memorizing Revelation. It is... it's a relationship, knowing God. I can hear his voice better. It's just burned the dross off my life. You know, I'm focused on the main thing, which is Jesus. And so what a tremendous blessing it is for me. I never know who has never heard these words before, who this is the last time they'll ever be invited to get the offer of the free gift of the water of life. or whether this will be the last time that I get to share it. I have a friend that just passed away this 2 days ago. Kind of a mentor, Jason Nightingale. He has been presenting Revelation for about 30 years. The only other person I knew that was doing it. And he just passed away, so I'm much even more appreciative of every opportunity we get to do what we do. But thank you for inviting me. Thank you in advance for supporting us. This is how I make our living. Acts of the Word is a nonprofit organization. We're non-denominational, so we're not just supported by some big denomination. We're supported by lots of little gifts from people all over the country. And what we do is we exist to inspire the church to act on God's words. And when I got saved out of Hollywood, one of my biggest convictions was that I did not want God's words to be considered just entertainment. You know, we see a lot of things, a lot of entertainment. I don't want you to put this in that category. And so I began to seek and fast and pray to God about that. And he led me to an organization called Food for the Hungry. They're an amazing Christian relief organization. And they help the poorest people on the planet. And they transform their villages. It takes them anywhere from 4 to 8 years to make villages self-sufficient. And they plant the next generation of the church. And they do amazing work. I've been in the field 3 times now with them overseas. I've met several of the kids that we sponsor as a family. And so God convicted me to present the needs of the poor and put their needs ahead of our ministry needs. And he's always been faithful to bless that. We've had thousands of kids' lives changed by me presenting the scripture. Everywhere I go, I present the needs of the poor, and we get kids sponsored. It's $35 a month. You can do it for as long or as short as you like, but if you do, you're gonna change somebody's future, and we have no idea the spiritual impact that we could have. Just words from us, anything from us, that affects somebody in a third world country. You know, it's like the richest person you know on the planet sending you a letter. You're going to read it over and over again. You're going to give it to all your friends. So that it's a great way to plant God's word in the hearts of kids. Those picture folders are on the table back there. If you want to, just pick up one of those folders. I think the boys are on one side, the girls are on the other. And open up the back. There's a form in there. Fill that form out, tear it off, and leave it with me. I'll be at the table back there. You can take the picture home. In about 2 weeks, you'll be able to start corresponding with your child back and forth. But thank you for having ears to hear this message right now. I really feel more and more so that every church should be focused on, the believers that are awake should be focused on waking up the rest of the church. You know, when you look at the parables Jesus taught about his second coming, all of the virgins fell asleep. All of them. Half of them woke up at the last minute. I mean, you know, they were all asleep. But it's all of the examples he gives of how the church will look right before he comes. It doesn't look that good. In other words, we're asleep, we're deceived. You know, he's warned us to not fall asleep, to be watchful, and to not be deceived. And that takes a humility of thinking that you don't know everything you need to know, and that you still need to be awake. So that's something that I'm feeling a sense of urgency with our ministry. So keep praying for us that we'll have even more opportunities to present Revelation in particular wherever I can, and to be able to offer people the gospel. But thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks. Thank you. Thank you.
Can we give Brother Marquise another warm amen? That was beautiful. Burleson family, I just want to leave with you as we close 3 invitations. Invitation number 1 is, I believe there is an abundance that is in store for each and every one of us here in the work of memorizing scripture. How many of us can use instruction or comfort? Any one of those two things, can we use that, instruction or comfort? Ellen White says in Great Controversy, many a portion of scripture which learned men pronounce a mystery or pass over as unimportant is full of instruction and comfort, and to him who has been taught in the school of Christ. That will be tough to access if we don't read versus when we do read, but I can tell you there's an even greater blessing in memorizing versus reading. There's an abundance on the way. So I want to invite you to that. Number two, as the deacons come forward, I want to invite you, we want to pick up a love offering for Brother Marquise Laughlin and his ministry. And if you're going to write out a check, we want to ask you to write it out actually to the Burleson Seventh-day Adventist Church. And then we will bring all those together and write him one big check, if that makes sense. Amen? Very good. And then the third invitation is, as we close, if you would go out and just thank Mr. Laughlin for his ministry, talk with him, connect with him, and just let him know that we were encouraged and we want to encourage him as well. And so as the deacons come forward, they will grab the love offering, we'll play a little music, and then we'll close with prayer. Want to wish you a happy Sabbath. Let us close with prayer. After prayer, many times we have burdens, extra weight on our heart that we are carrying, and we just need a special prayer. If that is the case for you today, our altar team will be here to my right, your left, and please feel free, you're invited to come forward and have special prayer upon you by our altar team. We just wish you a blessed Sabbath and a great rest of the week. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the love and the comfort and the compassion and the guidance and the instruction that you have for us in your word. John 10:10 says, the thief comes to steal and kill and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and have it abundantly. May we find that abundance in your word as we study and as we pray over it and as it is hidden in our hearts, as David said, so that we may not sin against you. So we thank you, and we look forward to a wonderful adventure in our upcoming week, walking with you side by side. We ask these things in Jesus' name as we all say together. Amen. Happy Sabbath, Burleson Church.